Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, peace be with you. Thank you for tuning into the Deen Show. We're going to be talking about the difference between judging someone and giving the loving advice. This week on the Deen Show, such an important topic. We're going to be covering it with my next guest, Sh.Omar Suleiman, here on the Deen Show. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
This is the Deen, Show. This is the Deen, Show.
This is the Deen,
This is the Deen,
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Now you just said something in Arabic. What'd you say?
I said, inshallah, God willing.
You said, assalamu alaikum. How are you? What does this mean?
Peace be with you.
It never gets old, because the Deen Show is known for simplifying things, making it very simple for the people, because some people out there, like, why are these guys speaking Arabic? Eddie, you're not Arab, you're an American. So we start off with peace, and you defined it. Assalamu alaikum. Tell us now, you've been on the Deen Show before, back when we were SD. Yeah. How's it feel being back now on HD?
MashaAllah. You look even better on HD, MashaAllah.
You did it again. See, the alarm is going off right now. See, we got this alarm when every time you say something in Arabic, you said MashaAllah. What does this mean?
MashaAllah means, admiring the creation of God.
Uh-huh. Now, there's a lot of not yet Muslims out there, and they're like, okay, why don't you guys just say these things in English? Why do you keep saying them in Arabic? How would you answer that?
It's a habit, that's one, obviously, and also the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to say these words. So we're emulating the Prophet, peace be upon him, saying these words, so it's part of our terminology.
Now, again, someone says, okay, what Prophet are you talking about?
The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
Real short, who was Prophet Muhammad?
Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the final messenger that was sent to mankind.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you accept Muhammad as a messenger, how do Jesus, Moses, and Abraham, how do they all fit in? Do you exclude them?
No, absolutely not. In fact, Allah says in the Quran that to disbelieve in any one of the messengers of God is to disbelieve in all of them.
So is it safe to say as soon as you accept Muhammad as the last, right away you accept all those that came before him?
Absolutely. You accept everything that he brought with him. So what he brought with him as well was the confirmation of the messengers that came before.
You said something in Arabic, Allah. People have heard it probably 1,000 times, but there's one person or 1,000 out there that tune in for the first time, and they think, okay, Allah, what is this? Why don't you just say God? Who is Allah?
Who is Allah? Allah is the God, the one true God, who sent these messengers and prophets to call to the worship of that one God, the same God of Islam, Judaism, Christianity, all of the religions that claim to believe in one God. The God of Abraham, peace be upon him, the God of Jesus, peace be upon him, and the God of all of them.
Is Islam a new religion? Is Islam something new that came with Muhammad?
Islam is a continuation of the same message of submission and attainment of peace by submitting yourself to God and submitting your will to God and obeying His commands. So Islam is the religion of God Himself, and it is the religion of Adam all the way, peace be upon him, to Muhammad, peace be upon him, and until God inherits this earth. So it is the religion of worship, worshiping one God.
I love it because it just makes sense. Islam makes sense. It's simple. It provides all the evidence and proof that you need to know that it's indeed from the Creator. It's not made up by a man or a group of men. It's indeed from the one who created mankind. And He sent all the guidance, the blueprint, how we need to live so we can be successful in this life and have eternal paradise in the next. The topic today that we want to discuss is the judging someone. Many people, when you try to give them the loving advice, and some people don't give advice obviously the right way, so how can you determine, Sheikh, what's the difference between when someone is judging you and someone is giving loving advice to you?
Use an Arabic word. You said Sheikh, you know.
So how do we, that's a good question. Someone think, what's this guy, he sells milkshakes, why do we call you Sheikh?
I don't know why you call me Sheikh. You tell me why you call me Sheikh. I don't call myself Sheikh. Well, these are all titles, whatever, that are used for respect and scholarship. But back to the question that you asked, you know, how do you determine what's loving advice and judgmental advice? Well, number one, are you giving advice for the sake of that person's good, or are you giving advice for the sake of your own ego? Many times when we give advice, it's to make ourselves feel better, not to make the other person feel better. The Arabic word for advice is nasiha. And nasiha means to purify. and it actually means to refine something. So the stage of purification, which is the last stage of purification, which is refinement. So the Arabs used to say, Nasahtul Asad. It's the refine that I refine the honey. And so the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said, Ad-deenu nasiha, the religion is sincere advice. And so what that means is that nasiha, when I give nasiha, when I give sincere advice, my goal should be to purify that other person of some flaw that they have, destructive quality that they might have, or characteristic, to help them out of a situation that's not good for them. So it should be for the sake of that person. If it's for the sake of that person, that will translate into beautiful words and into good advice and into good speech. And hopefully the person recognizing as well that this is coming from a good place, that this is not coming, you know, and it's interesting because the religion is sincere advice, and at the same time, Allah strongly, in the Quran, strongly condemned ridicule and mockery. Okay, so which is called sukhriya. And Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ. Allah says, let not one of you ridicule another group of you because they might be better than you. And let not a group of women ridicule a group of women because they might be better than them. And so the point is that if while I'm giving advice, I'm giving advice on the basis that I am better than you, and I'm telling you that I'm better than you, and I'm looking down upon you, then I'm not giving you advice, I'm ridiculing you. I'm doing something that's a major sin instead of something that the Prophet, peace be upon him, described as the entire religion, which is sincere advice for the sake of your betterment and bringing you close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and making things easier for you.
Has there ever been somebody that you sincerely wanted to give advice to, but you know you had that trepidation? Now that you're a little bit worried that there, you might break up a relationship or you might mess up a friendship between you and someone, but you really have this need, you have, because isn't it something that is incumbent on Muslims when you see something bad that you are to advise, that you are to invite to good, forbid evil? Have you ever been in this situation?
Absolutely. I think all of us have been in that situation. The idea is that how severe is their situation? And is it better for me to advise through words, or is it better for me to advise through example? Sometimes leading by example is much more effective than words. So there are some people that are just not in a position where they can properly accept advice. The Prophet, peace be upon him, he said that the worst people in the sight of Allah are those that people avoid giving advice to, ittiqa afuhshi, which means out of fear of his foul mouth. You know, there's some people that have a really bad temper, and if you try to give them advice, they're just going to flip at you. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said that those are the worst people, those people that are actually avoided because of their temper. So people just leave them alone and they essentially let them destroy themselves. So the point is that, again, there are some people that, you know, you avoid giving advice to because of their temper. There are some people that you avoid giving advice to because perhaps, you know, it's a minor thing that you want them to learn on their own. You're not at a point in your relationship yet where you have that level of trust where they can look to you and they can really, they see you in that advisor capacity. And so you want to sort of build that relationship a little bit more. I mean, da'wah is advice, right? So sometimes you don't give, you give da'wah through your actions. You give da'wah through you invite to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through your actions, through the way that you live your life and you carry yourself. But at the same time, you're not at a point in your relationship yet where you can speak to that person. And as an advisor, you need to really recognize when your advice is counterproductive, like the Prophet Abraham, peace be upon him. When his father responded to him with this threat of murder and humiliation, when he just called him with very gentle words, Abraham, peace be upon him, he didn't sit there and continue to advise him. He said, peace be unto you, I will seek forgiveness for you. Okay, and that my Lord is verily a gracious Lord. He's a compassionate Lord. He celebrates my supplication. So Abraham knew, peace be upon him, that his father was not in a position to receive advice anymore.
We're going to take a break. They're certainly going to have to go to break. But when we come back, I want you to give me a live example in your life or a story that you know that you advise someone turned out good and maybe something that turned out bad so we can benefit from a live experience. Sure. Think about it. We'll be right back with this and more here on The Deen Show.
I am not afraid to stand alone.
Back here on The Deen Show with my good friend, Sh.Omar Suleiman. Okay, so have you thought about a live example that now you got the courage, you got up and you were like, for the love of the Creator, I gotta talk to this person, whatever it was, or you end up getting smacked upside your head, something happened, good or bad, so we could benefit, or you know someone's relating a story. People like stories, they like to, you know, live examples.
Look, you've got to understand that, you know, particularly in my capacity as a preacher, as an imam, I've had many examples of where advice has gone well and many times where advice has not gone so well.
Tell us, please, share with us.
I have to be very careful.
Okay.
But, you know, because I don't want to sacrifice the trust of anyone. Yeah. But you know, just generally, I mean, I can remember many times where I'll catch up, you know, particularly I think that one of the major issues that we have with our youth in particular is obviously dating and relationships and things of that sort. So I can remember in particular, you know, one incident where, you know, I had to stop a brother that, you know, was, you know, dating and was getting to the point of committing fornication, you know, just outright fornication and things of that sort. And he wasn't heeding the religious warnings. And finally, when I sat with him and I spoke to him, I didn't necessarily talk about the consequences in the hereafter. I spoke more about the worldly consequences. And so that's one of the things when you're giving advice, you really want to try to stop that person from committing the sin by any means necessary, right? So I kind of spoke to him about his career, his family, and things of that sort. Then that finally humbled him to where he could also receive the advice about the hereafter as well. And, you know, I look back, I'll give you an example of where the Prophet, peace be upon him's advice went well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in the same situation where, you know, a young man came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and he told the Prophet, peace be upon him, Give me permission to commit fornication. I want permission to commit zina, to commit fornication. Now the Prophet, peace be upon him, he didn't smack him upside the head. He didn't tell him to go away. Rather, he reasoned with him. First and foremost, his smile, peace be upon him, was enough. You know, and talking to the man, the young man, in a way that he could properly understand in his capacity. So he tells him, you know, would you like someone to fornicate with your mother?
Mm-hmm.
And the man said, no. He said, would you like someone to do that with your sister? He said, no. He said, what about your aunt? He said, no. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, كَذَلِكَ النَّاسِ. That's how people are too. And he put his hand on his chest and he prayed for him. So the point is that the Prophet, peace be upon him, did not ridicule him. He didn't tell him that you'll go to hell if you fornicate. No, I'm not going to give you permission to fornicate. Rather, he came down to his level. He spoke to him on terms that he could understand. Now someone might say, I've actually had this situation where a father tells me, you know, I tried to tell my son, I said, would you be okay with someone dating your mother or committing adult fornication with your mother? He said, well, if you were dead and, you know, and mom, you know, was dating again. And so he said it totally didn't work. It backfired on him. And I told him, I said, the point is not necessarily the same words that the Prophet, peace be upon him, used here, but rather the approach. We learned from the manhaj, from the methodology of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And the methodology was to reason with him on his level and on his terms. And your body language expresses your sincerity, right? Expresses your compassion. It should express your concern. Okay, so there's a huge difference between, let's take the same words, okay? If I said to you, would you be okay with someone committing fornication with your mother? Or if I said to you, would you be okay with someone doing that with your mom? You see, it's the same words, but the approach, the way that it was expressed changed. One is with a smile and reasoning and really asking a question. The other one is, you know, is a form of condemnation. It's not really asking a question. It's condemning the person, the individual. So advice should be certainly to beautify that person, to make that person better. And it should express your concern and your compassion to that individual.
Now, there's a hadith, and I think it fits in quite well with this topic, where the Prophet, peace be upon him, he gave an example of people being on a ship. And if you can take off with this about, you had a certain group of people on the top of the ship and you had other people on the bottom of the ship. And then from here, if these people didn't come down and give them that loving advice, and then the ship ends up sinking.
This is a hadith that's narrated in Bukhari, actually. It's a very beautiful hadith where the Prophet, peace be upon him, he described the ummah, he described the nation as, you know, the believers as a group of people on a ship. And he says that the people on the upper deck, you know, are the worshippers, they're the religious ones, and then the people on the lower deck are the sinners. And he said, whenever they need water, they don't want to disturb those that are on the upper deck. So they drill a hole into the bottom of the ship to get their water. And so the people on the upper deck, they say that they come down and they yell at them and they say, why did you drill a hole into the bottom of the ship? And they say, because you were agitated by our asking you. You were irritated by us. And so the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that if they let them do that, then the entire ship sinks. Otherwise, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that the entire ship is saved. So the point is, there's so many different things. Actually, I teach a class called Prophetic Musings.
Yeah.
Some of the analogies of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And I go into quite some depth with this example. There's so many things. Number one...